Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to MPT webinar. Today's topic is planning of craniospinal irradiation. My name is Asad Yusuf. Okay, the content of the presentation is background, management, challenges in planning, treatment technique, QA setup, dose verification, and conclusion. So craniospinal irradiation is used for the treatment of medulloblastoma and other brain tumor, which tend to spread via craniospinal fluid. Because of the risk of subarachnoid seeding of tumor, surgery is followed by radiotherapy with boost to posterior fossa or tumor bed, and by the combination of chemotherapy. Medulloblastoma occur in cerebellum, portion of the brain that play a vital role in coordinating muscular movement. It is found rarely in adults, most commonly in children less than 19 years of age. So the management would be definitive treatment is surgery. Radiation is cornerstone of adjuvant treatment along with the chemotherapy. After chemo radiation, second phase of chemotherapy is prescribed again. So the challenges, immobilization and positioning. Immobilization and positioning of large target area, large and irregular shape of planning target volume, inhomogeneity at junction between the brain, spine and upper lower spine field, critical structure who may have late effect, especially for pediatric cases. So the planning step will be positioning, immobilization, simulation and CT, planning technique, verification, treatment, junction shift if needed. Immobilization and positioning. Patient can be positioned in two ways, supine or prone. Prone position. It is preferred and was standard for many years. Aids in visualization of field border. Relatively poor reproducibility. Difficulty in patient with anesthesiology to gain airway access. So it's quite difficult for the PEDS patient. Whereas the supine position is more comfortable and reproducible, easier to immobilize with head and neck mask, improved setup reproducibility of cranial field. No direct verification, of course, that's that disadvantage. So the treatment technique for CSI would be conventional treatment techniques, modified conventional techniques, jack field techniques, jack field 3D CRT on IMRT, semi-IMRT technique, IMRT technique, VMAT. Conventional techniques. So conventionally, symmetrical bilateral cranial field and posterior spine field are planned to cover entire length of the treatment volume. The inferior border of cranial field meet at the point of midway on the posterior neck surface. This technique rarely on single plane match and gap, junction in neck and spine region respectively. Due to this junction, a very low and high dose region are produced in the treatment volume. In the olden age, mostly CSI was treated on COBOL 60 machine having a jaws. There are no MLC, and the jaws are the symmetric. So they have to shift the junctions, and there is a limitation. But later on, when there are asymmetric jaws available, then of course they can shift the junction with the help of the jaw model instead of moving isocentra. So these are the old conventional technique picture. Now, theoretically for the students, it's quite important to understand how they used to do that in the past. So this details, you can find these details in Han Fazem Khan book on treatment planning. And so the geometrical method of orthogonal field separation, where D is the depth, and this is a SSD1. So the we are talking about the posterior field right now only. So these are the upper posterior spine field at which orthogonal field allowed to join. And this is a lower spine field. So here you can see if you are treating patient with SSD setup, this is a surface, of course, and this we are treating with a SSD setup. And here you can see there is a overlap region. So this will be a hot area. So we need a separation between these two so that there will be a cold spot and there will be a hot spot in the exit part. So for this, this is a formula could be used in order to calculate this gap. Modified conventional technique. So this is a formula of this technique. And here you can see this is a brain field and this is a spine field. And there is a junction. So the brain field is overlapping with the spine field. And remember that this is a left lateral or right lateral. And this is another field from here. So the bilateral fields are there and there will be another junction will be here. Overlap region. So in order to avoid that overlap, one can do the collimator or couch angle. This is the couch angle picture. Or another way is to give half beam block. So in the COBOL 60 machine, they have to introduce this half beam block technique because of the symmetric jaws. There's no asymmetric jaws in the COBOL in the past, in the older machines. So the collimator rotation, only with the hemi block of the cranial field. So in this way, you can match the junction. And this formula can be used for the calculation, how much collimation one have to give. So these are the techniques are useful if you're doing a manually or a 2D setups. In the modern era, we have a planning station, so that can be done easily in no time. And this is the way the junctions and field separation were done. And the marking was done in the pool if your patient is lying prone. So now, once we have MLCs, multi-leaf collimator, and we have an option of merge field on the latest algorithm and planning station. So jack field technique could be used, and with the help of asymmetric jaws, the feathering, MLC can be used for junction feathering, then single plane of brain. If you're talking about the asymmetric jaws, one has to create three plans for brain, three plans for upper spine, three plans for lower spine. But once you're planning with MLC, then you don't need multiple plans. Here you can see with the help of jaws. So we are talking about the jack field MLCs, and you can see the MLC here. You have to set the inferior border where the shoulder is clear. Then give the collimation. Here you can see the collimation, and the collimation was given in the thumb plan. You have to make two plans, one for the brain, one for the spine, upper spine, and make the plan sum. And you then give a little bit overlap, but the important part is the collimation. Here you can see the collimation of the lateral field is the divergence of posterior field is matched with the collimation of the lateral field. And for the MLC jack junction feathering, we need to do a bit overlap region so that there will be no cold spot during the planning. Here you can see the coronal plane in which the lateral fields are overlapping here. And this overlapping was controlled with the help of patch fields, multiple patch fields. And here you can see the perfect matching of the MLCs of the posterior field and also the lateral fields. In this way, you can produce a very good plan of 3D CRT, patient lying supine. So these are the steps of the jack field. Make the sum plan, the brain and spine, match divergence. And as all collimation is around 11 degree. Make three or two subfield with the MLC for each junction for feathering at the overlap region. The matching of MLC of VA borders subfield is not easy. You might have to move post spine isocenter. So the isocenter positioning is also very important. Because of the spatial resolution, you can't match perfectly. So you need to move isocenter a bit in the decimal places as well. For low spine, give couch angle to match the divergence of SPF. In similar way, overlap the field up to 2 to 3 centimeters and make the subfield with MLC width of 1 centimeter. And now calculate and optimize the individual plan and optimize the junction and sum plan while making the patches keep the same border. This match can be done with the couch angle. So the upper part match with the collimation and the lower part match with the couch angle. Here you can see the sagittal view. And I'm showing here the movement of the MLCs. And this is a BMI view. Now we'll talk about the IMRT, number of published paper you can find on the web. So CSI using IMRT allow homogeneous and conformal dose distribution through the target volume and reduce surrounding tissue dose. So with the 3D CRT, you have already noticed that there's a higher dose region out here. So the skin would burn, of course. But with IMRT, more conformity we can achieve and we can spare the skin. And we'll talk about the angles here. These are the steps, simplified step for IMRT technique. Set 2 or 3 isocenter on the same plan, depending on the size of the PTV and also the size of the patient. If there is a kid, you might, you don't need two spine field, only one spine field can work for you. If the PT can covered with one lower spine field. Placement is similar to 3D CRT. Set 5 or 7 field for brain, 3 field for upper and lower spine. Gantry angle for brain are given out here. These are the suggestions from the paper. Gantry angle of upper and lower spine are this. So there are going to be 3 isocenter and a single plan and can put all the fields in a single plan and can be optimized in the PO or whatever the optimizer you have. On the paper, the main focus during these IMRT plan, the main focus on OAR are the lens doses and also the kidney. These two are most important. Other than that, the other organs tolerance are higher because usually the CSI doses are quite low. So there's no need to worry about the other organs. You have to keep the organ as low as possible, but main focus, the main higher constraint or higher priority was assigned on the kidneys and the lens. So this is a plan evaluation. You can compare both the plans. IMRT plan here you can see, and skin sparing is there, but in the 3D CRT, you're giving higher doses. This is an inhomogeneous dose distribution in IMRT. Of course, you are sparing, you want to spare the lens, but here you get homogeneous dose distribution. But results in higher dose to the lens. In some of the cases, depending on if this area need to be covered, then of course lens dose will be exceeded. In 3D CRT and IMRT, you can reduce as more as possible. So another view. We're not going to talk about much. Talk about the VMAT. The most I will just discuss the important points. The VMAT, you can use 2 to 3 arcs. 2 arcs could be used on the brain and 1 arc, or if you require the lower spine, then of course 1 arc for the upper spine, 1 arc for the lower spine. And you can use the avoidance sector for the anterior portion when the gantry is moving anteriorly. You can select the avoidance sector. Here you can see there's avoidance sector was there. There's no distribution, dose distribution out there and anteriorly. So the advantage over IMRT is less monitoring units and conformity is same as IMRT. So the observations regarding 3D CRT skin reactions are observed due to higher dose on the posterior skin. QA of junction. So for the 3D CRT, of course, junction QA is important. It can be done with the film dosimetry. Whereas for IMRT and VMAT, the patient-specific QA is important. It can be done with the portal imaging. Octavius 4D allow us to cover the large fields, and the film dosimetry if you have a large EVD3 films. So the conclusion, both techniques have their pros and cons. Skin reaction observed in 3D CRT. Low dose region is higher in IMRT and VMAT. Higher monitor unit in IMRT, less in VMAT. No couch rotation is required in IMRT and VMAT, and that's the big advantage. It saves time for the radiotherapist. Dose in overlap region is diffused in IMRT and VMAT, whereas in 3D CRT is kind of jagged. The chance of overdose is higher in 3D CRT. These are the references, and thank you very much. CSI is challenging and demand precision. So one have to be expert while doing these kind of sophisticated plans, because you're dealing with the patient protection, obviously the first priority of the planner. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. Keep listening.